Hello, everyone. In this particular recording, we're going to discuss budget variances for both materials and labor. Okay, so in the last chapter, the most important concept was putting together the master budget. And of course, the master budget came in many pieces, starting with the sales budget, working through to the production budget, materials, labor, overhead budget, and so on and so forth, all the way down to the budgeted financial statements. So that the master budget, even if we didn't specifically say it in the last chapter, the master budget was based on the plan. Okay, so it was based on what we're going to call standards. Standards are basically the expectation of what should happen. The standard for the number of units we're going to make. The standard for the number of hours it's going to take to make a particular unit. Those are the standards, right? The norms. And because the master budget is prepared using standards, it's actually called a static budget. A static budget is basically a budget where the plan or the budget is based on our norms, but it is not adjusted to what actually happened. So simply put, a standard budget variance would be the difference between the static budget or the planning budget, the master budget, all right, there's many words for it, and what actually happened. So honestly, a variance is the difference between the actual and the budget. That's a basic term. If we're dealing with a static budget variance, it's the difference between the original planning budget and what actually happened. Okay. Now we got to move on to other types of variances after the static variances. Before we talk about that, the variances will either be favorable or unfavorable. I think this is pretty common sense. A favorable variance will ultimately have the result of increasing operating income. An unfavorable variance basically has the result of decreasing operating income. Okay, so make sure you know the variances are the differences between the actual and the budget. Favorable variances ultimately increase operating income, and unfavorable variance the opposite. Okay, so take a look at this slide here. This is what we call a level one analysis. Level one meaning very basic. As you can see on this slide, on the left-hand column, we have the actual results. In the far right-hand column, we have the original planning budget, the static budget. Okay. Now, you can see that the overall operating income, actual results, was $14,900. But the static budget was $108,000 for the planned operating income. That is a tremendous difference, okay? The actual results came in way lower than the static budget. Well, some of it can be as a result of just the fact that the units sold was different. And that's what makes the static budget not so informative, because we have to drill down a little bit more. See, with the actual results, how many units did we sell? And I'm circling it up here. We sold 10,000 units. But with the static budget, the planning budget, we were expecting to sell 12,000 units. Right at the top, you can see that there's over almost a $200,000 difference in revenues simply because of the amount of units we sold was different. And that goes a long way into explaining the bottom line operating income difference simply because of the number of units sold plan versus budget. Plan versus actual was 2,000 units different. Okay, so certainly that plays a role. And if you take a look at this, you might be thinking to yourself, wow, comparing actual results to the static budget is really not that helpful because we're comparing apples to oranges. Have you all heard that term before, comparing apples to oranges? For those of you that have not heard that slang term before, that simply means you're comparing two things that really shouldn't be compared. They're two different things. And that's exactly what we're doing here. We're comparing actual results based on 10,000 units sold to a static budget or a planning budget based on 12,000 units sold. Of course they're going to be different because we're comparing apples to oranges. So even though this is a first level one analysis, comparing the actual results to the original planning master static budget, we can take this a step further with our analysis. So taking this a step further, what we're going to do is we're going to take this static budget and we are going to flex it. So take a look at the title of this slide, flexible budget. And basically and think about what this word flex means. If you're talking about flexing your body, you're basically talking about stretching your body or changing the way your body is sitting. You're flexing. Okay, so basically what the flexible budget does is it changes the static budget to the actual units of output. So as an example, what we're going to do, and take a look at this slide, this is a level two analysis. With a level two analysis, we're getting a little deeper. So this first column, we have our actual results, if you remember. The actual results was based on 10,000 units sold, where we had operating income of $14,900. Now, if you remember, the level one analysis was simply comparing the actual results, which is column one, to the original planning budget, which was column five. That difference being a $93,100 unfavorable variance, meaning the operating income using actual results came in a lot less than the operating income that was budgeted for in the original master planning budget. So where the level two analysis comes in, where we're digging a little deeper, is what we're going to do is we're going to throw in this middle column here. If you see this middle column three, I'm circling it. It is now called a flexible budget. Flexible budget. So you can see with a flexible budget, what am I doing? I am now changing the static budget, which was based on 12,000 units sold. The flexible budget is now going to be based on the same amount of units that were actually sold. We are going to flex or change the budget based on the actual units sold. Now when we compare the actual results in column one to the flex budget in column three, now we can say we're comparing apples to apples. We're comparing the actual results where we sold 10,000 units to a budget that was flexed to 10,000 units sold. And you can see this is more of an apples to apples approach. And when we compare the difference between column one and column three, that is called a flex budget variance. And you can see we've gotten a lot closer. We still came in way under, our operating income is still unfavorable variance, okay, because flex to 10,000 units sold, we're still expecting a $44,000 operating income, but we actually got $14,900. So it's still an unfavorable flex budget variance. Okay, and then of course the difference between column three and column five, the flex budget versus the original budget, that difference is all because of the sales volume, 2,000 units difference. And you can see that some of the variances are favorable with an F and some are unfavorable. But it's an overall unfavorable variance. And compare, if you add up the sales volume variance and the flex budget variance, you are going to get the overall a static budget variance. Okay. Now, how do I know that the flex budget is 600,000 for direct materials of 621,000? Direct labor is 160,000 is the flex budget versus 198. The reason is these numbers, these budget numbers, there is an original cost formula that we used in the static budget. As an example, Some of these direct materials might be fixed costs and some might be variable costs. Remember, all of our costs are either fixed or variable, and we are going to use those cost formulas to figure out what the budgets should be for the flex budget as compared to the static budget. You can see they've changed, and the reason they've changed is because we've flexed them. We've changed them to the actual units sold. All right, so that's a little bit of a better view, the level two analysis. And like I said, the sales volume variance is simply the difference between the static budget and the flex budget. And it arises, and you can see the word is capitalized. It is solely from the difference between the actual volume and the budgeted volume. Once again, I'll go back to this slide. Column 3 versus column 5. The only reason because of these differences is simply because the unit sold was different. That is the sole reason for this sales volume variance difference. Okay? And we can see some possible reasons why we might have sales volume variances. Failure to execute the sales plan, weaker than anticipated demand, aggressive competitors taking away our market, unanticipated market preference away from our product, quality problems. You can go down the line. And certainly that's something that needs to be analyzed and figured out why it happened, and we will incorporate that into future budgets. Which brings me to a point before I move on to the next slides. Remember, the whole idea of analyzing actuals versus budget is so we can investigate, find out why we had the variances, both favorable and unfavorable. Of course, unfavorable, most people tend to want to find out why unfavorable much more than the favorable, but they really should both be investigated. And the reason they should be investigated is so we learn from our issues and we can incorporate what we learned into the next budget cycle. Remember, the budget is a never-ending cycle. It just changes over time and it morphs over time. And the better information we have to incorporate into better budgets into the future, the better off we're going to be. And then, of course, the flex budget variances. That is basically the flex budget variances, which ultimately will get us into a level three variance calculation. More on that in a minute. The flex budget variances are simply because our materials and our labor and our overhead variances are not because of a sales volume change, but because we missed our targets on the actual costs. So this is something that is serious, and we really need to drill down on our flex budget variances, especially on the expense side. And so what we're going to do to drill down on our flex budget variances, we're going to take that level two analysis that I showed you a few slides ago, and we're going to drill down on those flex budget variances and break it up into two smaller variance pieces. That is the level three analysis. Okay, so the best way to learn this is to take a look at this slide. All right, so a level three analysis is when we take the flex budget variance from the level two analysis and break it up into two pieces. And so you can see on this slide, I know this is a very busy slide, but this is probably one of the most important slides in the entire chapter. So the top part of this slide, let's concentrate on it. It's where we're going to take a look at the flex budget variance for the direct materials. Now, if I go back a few slides, and I'm going to come back, but if you take a look, I want you to know where we are at. You see this direct materials line item? What was the flex budget variance? It was $21,600. Do you all see I'm circling it with my cursor here? So the actual results, direct materials used $621,600 worth of materials. But I was budgeting for this level of activity $600,000 of direct materials. There is a difference of $21,600 unfavorable variance. So let me come back and I want to show you. You see I'm circling it with my cursor right now. The overall flex budget variance is unfavorable $21,600. And what we're going to do with the level 3 analysis is we're going to break up this flex budget variance into two pieces. And the way we're going to do that is as follows. It's really this three-column approach. So over here in the far left, we're going to look at our actuals. Do you guys remember the actuals were $621,600? And over here, all the way in column 3, where you can see it says flex budget, it came to how much? $600,000. So once again, I'm going to go back a few slides so you can understand where these numbers are coming from. So here's the actual results, $621,600, and the flex budget was $600,000. Okay? So that's where these numbers came from. But when we take a look at how they were calculated, the actual direct materials of $621,600 was based on the actual quantity, which was 22,200 square yards. That was the actual quantity used, times the actual price paid for the materials, $28 a square yard. Actual quantity times actual price. That gave us the $621,600. But if I come all the way over to the far right column with the flex budget, the budget for the direct materials was 2 square yards per unit. And remember, for this activity level, how many do we actually make? You guys remember? 10,000 units. That was what we actually made for this activity level, times the budget, which is 2 yards per unit. So 10,000 units times 2 square yards times the budgeted price. So this is the budget quantity for this level of activity times the budget or the standard price. The standard price here was $30 a square yard. When you do that math, the budget for this level of activity should have been $600,000. And so the way we're going to break up the actuals to the budget for this level of activity is we're going to throw in this middle column here. Let's call this column 2. And take a look at what column 2 is. We're going to take the actual quantity from column 1. And remember, the actual quantity is 22,200 square yards. We're going to steal that from column 1 times what? Times the budgeted price. We're going to steal the budgeted price from column 3. That's $30 per square yard. Now when we throw in this middle column, now what we're going to do is we're going to compare column 1 to column 2, and we're going to compare column 2 to column 3. So take a look at column 1 versus column 2. What is column 1? 22,200 times $28 per square yard. In column 2, the actual quantities are the same, but the difference is in the price, $28 per square yard versus $30 per square yard. So the difference between column 1 and column 2, the difference is in the price. Let's call that a price variance. And when we used our actual price, 28, versus our budgeted price, 30, when we use our actual price, it came in less than the budget. Let's call that a favorable variance. Now let's compare column 2 to column 3. The difference is not in the price. The price is the same, $30 per square yard in both column 2 and column 3. The difference is in the quantity. So let's call that an efficiency variance. You can see using the actual quantity, where we calculated 666,000, compared to the budgeted quantity for this level of activity, when we use the actual quantity, we came in much higher than what we were budgeting for this level of activity. We used much more square yards than we were budgeting for. We were inefficient with our materials. That is why we have an unfavorable efficiency variance. And when you add up the $66,000 unfavorable variance with the $44,400 favorable variance, we still have an overall unfavorable variance, but you could see it's less. It's $21,600, which is the $66,000 less the $44,400. So you can see we're actually zoning in a little bit more. This is the level three analysis, where we're breaking up the flex budget analysis into two pieces. And when I take a look at this, I say to myself, okay, I can clearly see that we did very poorly with the amount of materials used on the manufacturing assembly line. We used 22,200 square yards when we were only supposed to use 20,000 square yards. Somebody screwed up. Either we had an employee that made a mistake, maybe a machine was malfunctioning, maybe we were doing some training and the trainees were, you know, using more materials than they were supposed to, so there was more scrap. Whatever the case may be, this is something we would need to analyze, why we have an unfavorable efficiency variance, why we used more materials than what was budgeted for this level of activity. On the other hand, when we have our price variance and we see it's favorable, clearly it's favorable because we only spent $28 a square yard and we were budgeting for $30. What happened? Did we change vendors? Did the quality of what we purchased go down and therefore the price went down? Did we get a price discount? Was it a one-time price discount? Is it baked in permanently into the future? Did we change vendors? I mean, there's so many questions that need to be asked, but the bottom line is we are going to learn from these variances and incorporate them into the next year's variance. Now let's do the level three analysis for labor. The same thing for labor. You can see over here in the far left-hand column one, we have our actuals. So our labor came to 198,000, and for this level of activity, which is making 10,000 units, we should have spent $160,000 in labor. So once again, the actuals 198, the flex budget 160. That is an overall flex budget variance of 38,000 unfavorable. It's unfavorable because the actuals is $38,000 higher than what we were expecting for this level of activity. And let me go back a few slides so you can see this again. We're talking about this line item here that I'm circling, the direct manufacturing labor. You can see the actual for this level of activity, 10,000 units sold. The actual labor came to 198,000. The flex budget, 160,000. That's a $38,000 difference. It is an unfavorable variance. And when we break that up, we're going to do it the same way as we did with the materials. In column one, we have the actuals. And since we're dealing with labor, we're going to take the actual hours worked times the actual rate. So our employees worked 9,000 hours times, and they were making $22 an hour. That's where we got our actual dollars, 198,000. Now, if we come all the way over to the far right, column three, we're going to take the hours that we were supposed to work, basically the standard hours for this level of activity. For every unit, our standard or our norm is 0.8 hours. So to make 10,000 units times 0.8 hours, that is my standard hours for this level of activity, times the standard hourly rate is $20 an hour. That would give us the 160,000. And so what we're going to do is we're going to throw in this middle column too, where we're going to steal the actual hours from column one, 9,000 hours from column one. We'll put it into column two, and we will steal the standard rate from column three. The standard rate is 20. And so this middle column, 180,000, what we're going to see is the difference between column one and two is not in the hours, but in the rate. $22 an hour is the actual rate, and the standard rate was $20 an hour. Let's call this a rate variance or a price variance, okay? And you can see the differences when we used our actual rate. It was higher than the standard rate. Therefore, it's an unfavorable rate variance or price variance. Now over here, comparing column two to three, the rates are the same, $20 an hour. The difference is in the number of hours worked. So using the actual hours worked, it came in higher than using the standard. Once again, also an unfavorable variance. So we used more hours to make this level of activity than we were budgeting for. And on top of it, we paid higher hourly rate than we were budgeting for. So both of them are unfavorable variances, both pieces. We were inefficient with our time, right? We spent more hours than we were supposed to for this level of activity. In addition to being inefficient with our time, we actually paid more per hour. So this is something we need to look at. Did we hire new people and they're not yet fully trained and they're using more hours than they were supposed to at this level of activity? Did we have a machine malfunction and we spent a lot of hours trying to work around this machine malfunction? Did we give out raises? Was it a one-time raise? Is it a bonus? Is it a one-time bonus or is it a raise that's going to be incorporated into the future? I don't know. These are things that we are going to figure out. And once we've come to the conclusions for the reasons for our variances, we will then go ahead and incorporate that into our future budgets that we prepare. So level three analysis, once again, is when we drill down on our flex budget variances and break it up into two pieces. I know I spent a whole ton of time on level two analysis and especially level three analysis. But once again, guys, this level two and level three analysis is the key to understanding the variance analysis. Once again, the variance is the difference between the budget and the actual. And when we get down to level three analysis, we're showing the difference between the flex budget and the actual. Remember, the flex budget is changing of the budget to the actual activity level. In this example, the actual activity level is 10,000 units. All right, and so you can see this slide here is just a summary of everything that we've done. Once again, the level one analysis is just coming up with the static budget variance, the difference between the actuals and the original planning master static budget. There's not much analysis there. And then we're going to take it to a level two analysis. The level two analysis is when we're going to come up with our flex budget variances. You can see the flex budget variance of 29,100 unfavorable is the sum of these numbers, the price variances and the material variances and the labor variances and the overhead variances. These last two we didn't actually get to in this chapter. We'll discuss more about that in a future chapter. And then lastly, the level three analysis, which is what we just finished. We're going to break up our materials variance between our price and efficiency variance. And we're going to break up our labor variance between our rate and our efficiency variance as well. So this is a nice summary. All right. And each variance is, by the way, can be journalized. We can actually record journal entries. And this is something that I am going to go through in more depth when I go through your answers for your homework for this chapter. So stay tuned and make sure you listen to that recording where we're going to go through our journal entries for our variances. Straight out favorable variances, they're going to be recorded with credits. Unfavorable variances, they're going to be recorded with debits. And at the end of the day, take a look at the last bullet point. Remember, we're going to record our standards as journal entries along with the variances. That's basically what we're recording. And after we record the standards and the variances, all of the variance accounts, so whatever we have, the credits and the debits, the variance accounts, we're going to usually close them out to cost of goods sold at the end of the period, if immaterial. If they're material, then we got to make some more choices as to where to close them out to. All right, but if they're immaterial, and hopefully they are immaterial, we're just going to close out all of our variance accounts, you know, whatever is needed to zero out the accounts, close it all out to cost of goods sold. Standard costing, like I said, with standard costing, We're going to use the standards or the targets or the budgets for direct material and the direct labor. And as I said a few seconds ago, the standards are actually recorded in the accounting system, and the actual prices, the actual uses, they're compared to the standards and the variances. And they're all going to be recorded in journal entries. And of course, variances, they need to be analyzed so we can incorporate what we learn into the future. That's basically what we're doing here in this particular chapter.